In my last video essay, the critically acclaimed How Disney Worlds Contribute to the Kingdom Hearts Story parentheses or don't.
I'm a fan of Regular Pat's videos. This is his finest work. This is his magnum opus.
I took a way too hard look at every Disney World in the numbered Kingdom Hearts titles and gave my opinion on how each one succeeded or failed in integrating itself with the larger KH plot. Originally, the plan was to include analyses on the worlds of Birth by Sleep and Dream Drop Distance, but I ended up cutting that for the sake of time and the sake of me wanting to put a video out sooner. If you missed that video, I'd recommend checking it out before watching this one so you have an understanding of my perception and grading scale for this stuff. So today we're back to finish what I started and take a look at the PSP and 3DS titles to round out what I consider the big five of the series. Quick aside, I've always maintained that the numbered titles have been the core of the series, but that the bridge or stepping stone games, so to speak, are still worthwhile and would encourage newcomers to the series to play or watch anything they can get their hands on. That being said, I do sort of mentally organize the games into different importance tiers with the numbered titles in a class of their own, followed by Birth by Sleep and DDD. Then there's Chain of Memories, Days, and I guess now Melody of Memory, and then probably Recoded by itself beneath that. Placing the microtransaction experiences is tricky given their current status, but they also do contain fairly consequential material, so those ones are up to you. With all that in mind, I don't have a ton of interest in covering anything under this second tier for this particular exercise, mostly because their formulas start to look fairly different when compared to those big five games. But I do discuss the Disney floors in Castle Oblivion a bit in my Chain of Memories retrospective from last year if you're interested in that. Before getting properly started, I found that the way these two games approach this task of integration tends to differ pretty substantially. Birth by Sleep is, from my perspective, a lot more concerned with character growth and intersectionality between the three campaigns. Whether or not it succeeds at this is up to you. But I find that these worlds will often reference or acknowledge the external plot and conflict, but rarely have any juicy plot points or players from that larger external plot showing up and driving stuff forward. In that way, I find BBS to be, fittingly, more like KH1 than the other two if we were to compare notes with our last outing, albeit this game is perhaps not as tight or natural feeling as the first installment. On the flip side, there's Dream Drop, which does have a few character moments throughout its Disney worlds which we'll discuss, but overall is more akin to KH2 in that we'll more often have visitors from outside worlds, though these appearances are brief and not always cohesive with the worlds they occur in. But unlike KH2, I can say that something resembling an effort is made in the Dream Drop worlds more often than not. I think it makes the most sense to work our way from the bottom to the top again, just to get those fledgling negative emotions out of the way. So welcome back to the You Go Girl, Give Us Nothing tier. Joining these illustrious ranks is the high fructose corn syrup clusterfuck that is Disney Town, to nobody's surprise. The trips to this corporate minigame town are brief and incredibly insulated. The protagonists will reference each other and have small moments of self-reflection, but that's gonna happen pretty much everywhere, so I'm not gonna be too generous for that. Terra in particular learns a so-called lesson after dealing with Captain Dark that he doesn't always need to bend the rules to achieve his goals, which really comes out of nowhere for me. I don't know why the game is asking me to buy this, especially since we'd been playing as Terra for the past 4.5 worlds at this point. The worst thing he'd done up to this point was not of his own volition, and his conduct in the other worlds he'd visited was completely by the books, so I don't know where this forced false epiphany is coming from. If it's because of the whole giving into darkness thing back in Radiant Garden, I don't even really consider that bending the rules. That was, like, again, a sort of provoked and involuntary reaction, but I digress. Cut yourself a break, Terra. Then you've got Ventus and his campaign with his frankly offensive claim that nobody is looking out for him. If anything, Aqua is explicitly and almost obnoxiously looking out for him, sometimes to the point of it being stifling. I get that the Radiant Garden meetup was pretty rough for everyone and that Ven is like 12/1000, so maybe his brain isn't finished cooking yet or maybe overcooked, but geez, I mean, what a brat. Here's the part of the video where I put up that SpongeBob meme of him mocking Ven. Also, Aqua gets, like, nothing to do here, so negative points for all of that. The most credit I can give this world is showing us the origins of Team Rocket when Maleficent recruits Pete, and we're really scraping the bottom of the lock, shock, and barrel for that one. Moving over to Dream Drop, we have the country of the Musketeers, the only world in the game to lack a visit from an organization member, which are encounters that basically do all of the heavy lifting in this game when it comes to this integration exercise, so this world really suffers for it. I kind of have a distaste for this world already, whether for it being based on a direct-to-DVD movie when there's a panoply of unused properties to use, That movie being a deliberately confusing choice exclusively featuring alternate versions of characters we already know, or for it being France after literally going to France like 3 hours ago. But even putting all of that aside, this is truly the fillerest of the filler. I do appreciate that Dream Drop Sora, the dumbest of the Soras, finally realizes that these dream iterations of his friends aren't going to recognize him, and he uses his prior knowledge of Tron and Jiminy to reach that conclusion, but it doesn't really build toward anything or say anything interesting. I like the continuity there, but this isn't leading anywhere, it's just the game's plot bending backwards to justify having these repeat characters in new environments, not the other way around. Since Sora is interacting with these versions of his friends who literally don't matter at all, I find very little intrigue in building the SDG camaraderie from scratch, this time more hastily and with more ham-fisted lines. Riku's visit is somehow worse, like I have nothing to say. Not even an end of cutscene muttering to himself about friendship or darkness or whatever, this is just like a purely episodic save-the-day story with nothing else to chew on. Alright, we're moving up one tier now to the Can You Try A Little Harder tier, although many of these are closer to the lower end than the higher end of this one. To avoid burying the lead here, I think all but one of the remaining Dream Drop worlds belong in this tier, because I'm often struggling to find anything super meaningful being said or explored in these outings. They're all visited by some combination of organization members, but only for one scene per visit. More often than not, these visitors aren't saying anything relevant to the world at hand, they're just plopped in at the end to sort of give the illusion of integration, a dream of it, so to speak. At the bottom here is Symphony of Sorcery, which is by all other metrics one of my favorite Disney worlds in the series, but does little for the sake of this exercise. I'd imagine it's difficult to do a ton in this regard with a place that went all in on the environment and is populated entirely by the crowd of roaring fans from the Coliseum, but even young Xehanort's appearance here is pretty middling and could have just as well happened anywhere else. He comments on how beautiful the world is, teases the big twist to Sora, and then fucks off. On Riku's side, he taunts him a bit, says he's no use to the true organization, and then summons Chernabog, because behind every great immortal demon hellspawn, there's an even greater time-traveling edgelord. You know, as the old saying goes. Next is the just slightly better
La Cité des Cloches,
but not even really for its respective organization visits, which are just as tacked on to the end of each campaign, especially Sora's, where young Xehanort and, for some reason, Vanitas briefly appear to say literally two lines before leaving. It was like he was just passing through and didn't realize Sora was also gonna be there at that moment, so he just came up with something to say as he was walking from one dark corridor to the next. Nice, nailed it. I looked and sounded so cool just then. Riku's side features a visit from young Xehanort and Ansem, though both just kind of generally taunt him and do a bit of dark splaining. The scene with Riku and Quasimodo is honestly way more interesting and illustrative of Riku's growth, like it feels more aware that we're dealing with a character with a 10-year history and not just any old original character plopped into
La Cité des Cloches
to save the day. Just above that is Prankster's Paradise, which is also carried by its organization visits, and these ones are slightly stronger and more tied into the world we're dealing with. Sora gets a visit from young Xehanort and Xemnas, and will act super shocked to see the latter even if you already went to the grid and met him there.
Xemnas! Xemnas? This isn't possible!
What the fuck?
And the two basically talk through a watered-down version of the Monstro plot from KH1, commenting on how even a puppet can end up growing a heart. Sora also inadvertently hints that nobodies can grow hearts too, which sets us up for a later reveal. Riku's side, taking place entirely inside the belly of the beast, features a brief visit from his dark counterpart. He doesn't say anything, but his appearance gets the real thing ruminating, and Pinocchio is like, "Say, Riku, how do you keep from ripping innocent people limb from limb without a little bug in your hair telling you what to do all the time?" And he's like, "It's simple, Sora is my Jiminy Cricket, I literally can't differentiate right from wrong without him." I'm embellishing a bit, but that's pretty much the conversation. I think Riku's selling himself a bit short here to be crediting Sora with literally being his conscience equivalent, but they tied the discussion there into the world, which is how you get points in this exercise. One Birth by Sleep world I'm putting in this tier, and definitely on the lower end, is Olympus Coliseum, which doesn't really have a ton going on. Birth by Sleep is often gonna scatter little flashback moments or brief visual hallucinations to tie things back to the original plot, and sometimes they work, and sometimes they feel kind of forced, like here with Ven momentarily envisioning Zack and Hercules as Terra and Aqua. There's not really anything inherently interesting about that to me beyond these are two pairs of friends that Ven has made and they're both engaged in a friendly sparring match, and maybe the game doesn't want us to make anything more out of it, I don't really know. I think the strongest visit here is Terra's, which is sort of a microcosm of his overarching story, with Hades playing the Xehanort role here. Terra generally seems to get a stronger narrative through line and more interplay between his Disney visits and what's going on in the larger KH universe. I mentioned this when I ranked all of the Birth by Sleep worlds, but small things like Terra remembering how Maleficent hypnotized him and noticing the similarity with Zack here makes these worlds feel less episodic. Aqua and Ven's visits are pretty lacking though, and Aqua's is especially frustrating considering there could have been some intrigue during her visit regarding how everyone's talking about Terra if you for some reason played Aqua's campaign before his, but that goes for a bunch of worlds in her campaign, unfortunately. The last world in this tier is the Castle of Dreams, which as a whole isn't doing a lot, but it has that meetup between Terra and Aqua as the sort of crux of the world alongside the undercurrent theme of following your dreams, with Ven reminiscing about training alongside Terra back in the Land of Departure. Birth by Sleep is generally bigger on the thematic parallels, whereas Dream Drop has those organization member visits and small plot teases. The interpersonal drama of BBS is always either at the forefront or taking an equal share of the plot's attention in most of the Disney worlds. We're moving up to the next tier here, which is actually the last one. I should also note, it might seem like we're breezing through this, he said at the 10 minute mark, but rest assured, I'm leaving no stone unturned here. I didn't cherry pick moments, I pulled everything I could find. But when comparing to the mainline games, I don't think there's anything left that's really on par with KH1 Monstro and Neverland, Space Paranoids, or Monstropolis. There's one that I'd have higher than the rest, but not enough to clear that threshold and put it alongside those four masterclass worlds. A lot of these are at least going for something, but I'd still slot most of them in the lower end of this tier. Like, nothing here is really as good as Beast Castle and Cage 2, but one or two may come close. Starting off here, we have Deep Space, which really hones in on the interpersonal drama and those parallels. Deep Space is sort of a weird one. It's probably the most interesting in terms of the timeline of the different protagonist visits, and it's still pretty much entirely self-referential, but it centers pretty deeply around the relationship between the trio. It basically revolves around all the Stitch Wayfinder stuff and the pseudo-parallels of Stitch and either Terra or Ven and the Councilwoman and Ericus, with Aqua basically just playing the part of herself, the arm of the law. Again, I talked about this in those BBS world rankings, but Stitch is showcased as this destructive force but still capable of good, like Terra, and also as the little brother who wants to tag along and help out, like Ven, which is pretty fun. So nothing earth-shattering here, but another world that feels chiefly focused on these three characters, and more so using the Disney stuff as a complementary backdrop. Also on the lower end of this tier, I've got the Grid, though I'm actually surprised it ended up this high. Here, Sora is visited again by young Xehanort and Xemnas, who talk about memories and how they work differently in a digital world. They also reference Space Paranoids, which contextualizes the existence of the Grid as the original version of that copied system. It's not quite as impactful as Space Paranoids was in KH2, but it's still an effort to tie things together. And just generally, throughout the world, Sora has to contend with the idea of Tron having been turned into Rinzler, and whether or not the former still exists or remembers him deep down, which is something we see a lot of throughout the series, whether this parallel was intentional or not. Xemnas also hints that Sora has been chosen as the 13th vessel for the True Organization, which is, in hindsight, probably the most interesting nugget of information we get teased to us in one of these Dream Drop Disney worlds. Riku's side, while lacking any appearances from the organization, has him performing a little monologue to himself after meeting up with Kevin Flynn. He talks about how setting your sights on one particular goal can harm those around you, which he ties back to Xehanort. Funnily enough, when Riku was describing that, I initially thought he was talking about himself, someone who was intensely focused on seeing other worlds and becoming stronger, and undoubtedly harmed those around him because of it. I'm not sure if Riku or the game was conscious of the double meaning here, but I think it's a pretty fair reading of the moment. Somewhere a bit higher, I've got Dwarf Woodlands, which again earns most if not all of its points on the back of Terra's visit. As is the case for the other pre-Radiant Garden worlds, Terra's visit here centers around his search for Master Xehanort, and so everything Terra does here is in pursuit of that goal. The fact that the Evil Queen is willing or allowed to utter the words Master Xehanort already puts this above a lot of KH2 worlds under this exercise. And the magic mirror actually, like, having knowledge and being a legitimate source of outside information despite being a single world Disney character really harkens back to those Genie and King Triton moments from KH1. That's the meat of what I like about this world, whereas Ven's visit is, again, kind of ruined and has the tension sucked out of it before you even arrive if you've already played Terra's campaign, which is Nomura's recommended play order, so go figure. I'm also a fan of Aqua's flashback to Ven being asleep at the Land of Departure when she's looking at Snow White. It's something you could realistically pull off with any character who happens to be asleep, but it's a smooth flashback and consistent thread between two characters who are famously narcoleptic. Right alongside Dwarf Woodlands is Neverland, which is kind of a retread of the deep space dynamics, just sub out the Wayfinder for the Wooden Keyblade, but the world gets a big boost from Vanitas showing up at the end of Aqua's visit. It doesn't really need to be in Neverland, but it's like the only time we have someone who isn't TVA visiting a Disney world, so it's at least something. Everyone also gets a flashback to the start of the game in Land of Departure, which again could have been done in any world, but given that Neverland is, much like it was in KH1, the beginning of the end, it's a good spot to draw attention back to the emotional stakes. Whether or not it works and whether or not you've grown attached to or invested in the trio by this point is, again, up to the individual. I might have this world too high, but it just overall feels like it's more concerned with the trio than any of the Peter Pan stuff. Like, yeah, we're going on treasure hunts and pissing off Captain Hook, but it all sort of feels secondary to all the TVA stuff. Or even something small like Michael showing up and getting bullied by Vanitas and his star shard getting passed around. It's nothing massive by any stretch of the imagination, but it feels like the outside plot is passing through here and continuing to develop instead of being put on pause for a long stretch of 8 or 9 worlds. Finally, at the top of the list out of the offerings from Birth by Sleep and Dream Drop is Enchanted Dominion. This world essentially kicks off the game, since if you're playing as Terra first, this is your mandatory first stop, and it makes a pretty good impression. It's sort of a shame that the rest of the worlds don't quite measure up in my eyes. But a lot of the world's success in this department is, believe it or not, due to the presence of Maleficent, who's kind of baked in as a character who, by virtue of us already knowing her future plans, naturally works as a bridge between Disney and original KH. So in addition to the usual dramatic irony that we experience when Terra is palling around with your typical Disney villain, we know the extent of Maleficent's plot in KH1, and we're basically witnessing the formative moments of the Princess of Heart plan that'll come to fruition in 10 years. And given the little retcon of Xehanort being the one to plant all of that in Maleficent's horned little head, his presence and influence is most felt in this world, not counting the ones where he actually physically appears. Even though his actions are undone by the end of Ven's visit, it felt like we were seeing something pretty monumental when Terra was mentally bamboozled into taking Aurora's heart. Maleficent still gets her way in the end, so this was like a soft launch of the Princess of Heart plot for her. It's the biggest singular moment to transpire in these three princess worlds, and it feels like the rest of the game is sort of living in the aftershocks of that moment. And since Terra is the first to visit, with Ven and Aqua essentially dealing with the consequences of quote-unquote his actions, the tension between the trio is most felt here out of all of the pre-Radiant Garden worlds. On top of that, we get a rare meetup between two protagonists, something that only happens twice outside original worlds, this time with Aqua and Ven, with Maleficent trying to gaslight Girl Boss and literally gatekeep them. Like, she uses gates to keep Aqua in the castle. I don't know, there is something there. The scripts tend to get weaker towards the end. But for those reasons, I think I can comfortably slot Enchanted Dominion as the strongest example out of this batch of worlds, though still not quite reaching that maximum potential of a world like Space Paranoids. Overall, when it comes to grading the efforts of all five games, I look at it like this. I felt like KH1 was the most consistent, and naturally I still have it at the head of the pack. Following that, and to the chagrin of people who I don't care about, is KH3, which got bogged down in doing the movie plot-itis on occasion, but still usually put forward an honest effort. That leaves KH2 with the bronze, but after this addendum, I might have Birth by Sleep either on par with or pulling out just ahead of it. Strictly in terms of this exercise, KH2 has higher highs but also lower lows than BBS, whereas the latter felt more consistent, if not very flashy or exciting. Definitely more of a slow burn, and again built on the relationship between Terra, Aqua, and Ven. Dream Drop is, for me, pretty comfortably the worst out of the big five, with no real highs to speak of, but it does at least attempt something all but one time in its admittedly smallest pool of worlds. But that brings us to the end of this project in its entirety, until I'm harassed enough or strapped for cash enough to start looking at Days and Recoded. Or until KH4 comes out. It'll be that first one. Hello, hope you liked that little follow-up there. If you did, please consider smashing the gently caressing the thumb upwards button. I feel like with this one, I'm more easily swayed on some of my placements on these things. I could definitely see myself being convinced that something is too high or too low. Some of these were just like so, you had to get so granular with like the details of each scene that I figured it could really go either way in terms of the tier they landed in. So let me know if you think I really balls this up. And if you really enjoyed, I would love if you would consider supporting yours truly on patreon.com. Believe it or not, that is the most consistent and substantial portion of my income, and it's definitely the most reliable way to ensure that I can continue to make these videos. In a perfect world, I would have something that I'm proud of uploaded every other day, and just live off of the YouTube money there. But that's YouTube is not a reliable source to put food on the table. So my patrons really are doing the heavy lifting there, and I cannot express enough how much I appreciate that. Thank you for watching and sticking with me here. I will now throw it to those aforementioned patrons and some pretty cool fan art. All right, take it easy. I'll see you next time.